Welcome to the video lecture on embedded systems. In today's topic, we are going to deal with general purpose input output devices which are to be connected with the ARM7 processors. So today we are going to cover the peripherals part, and in that we are going to see the general purpose input output devices which are to be connected to the ARM7 microprocessors. So let us first go through the features of the general purpose input output devices for ARM7. Now see that every physical GPIO port in ARM7 is accessible via either the group of registers providing an enhanced feature and accelerated port access, or the legacy group of registers. That means we are having two types of ARM7 GPIO ports, that is the slow ports and the fast ports. Okay. For faster response, we are going to use the fast ports. Okay. And there are this group of registers which are being used to configure the GPIO port for the ARM7. Now see that as an enhanced version, there is an accelerated GPIO function. So this GPIO registers are related to the ARM local bus so that the fastest possible IO timing can be achieved using the fast GPIO. Now in the accelerated GPIO, there is a mask register also. So mask registers allow treating sets of port bits as a group, leaving other bits unchanged. So all registers are byte and half word addressable, and entire port values can be written in one instruction. Now see that a bit level set and clear registers allow a single instruction set or clear of any number of bits in one port. Means there is a bit addressing capability also, or a particular bit of the port can be set or cleared using the set and clear registers available in the ARM7. Direction control of individual bits is possible using the direction register, and all IO default to inputs after reset. That upon reset, all the input output ports are configured as input. Okay. Backward compatibility with other earlier devices is maintained with legacy registers appearing at the original address on the ARM peripheral bus. Okay. Means the addresses are not being changed, they are being backward compatible. Okay. So whatever the programs that we write for the earlier ARM processor, that will work on the advanced versions also, because the advanced versions are backward compatible. So these are the few features of the ARM7 GPIO. Let us proceed further. The applications of a GPIO is a general purpose input output. We can add any peripheral like LED or a switch or any input or output devices to the general purpose input output devices. Okay. So a general purpose IO is provided by the GPIO, driving LEDs or other indicators, controlling off-chip devices and sensing digital inputs. These are the few applications of the GPIO. Now let us proceed further with the ports. The chip that we are going to use, the microcontroller chip that we are going to use, is LPC2148. So for an ARM7 port 0 is a full 32-bit port, is available as a general purpose input output, and the number of GPIO actually available depends on the use of alternate functions. So port 0 can be used as a 32-bit IO port, okay, and port 1 lower 16 bits are being used by the system, so it cannot be used as a general purpose IO, but P1.16 to P1.31 can be used as input output or a general purpose input output. Okay. So in ARM7 we are having P0.0 and P0.31 which can work as an IO pins, and P1.16 to P1.31 which can be used as an IO pin. Okay, so we are having two ports. Now see that all these pins are having dual functionality. For port 0, to configure all the pins by upon reset, basically they are being configured as general purpose input output, but if we are using some of the port pins for some other purpose, then we are supposed to take care of pin select register. Okay, so there is a pin connect block in the ARM7 which will perform the dual functionality of all these pins. So that can be done by the pin select register. So we are having pin select 0 register, pin select 1 register and pin select 2 register. So pin select 0 and pin select 1 is used for port 0 for its dual functionality, and pin select 2 will be used for port 1 for its dual functionality. Okay, so that is to be configured first if we are using some of the pins of this port for alternate functions. So pin connect blocks will come into the picture whenever we are writing a program. If we are simply going for a GPIO program, then we can simply put all the pin in the pin select block as general purpose IO, and that will work as a GPIO. Okay? Or initially upon reset they are as GPIO pins, so there is no need to write the pin select in the program. Okay? So whenever it is necessary for the alternate function, we will use the pin connect block, and in the pin connect block we will configure the pin select registers. Okay. So let us proceed further with the GPIO register description. Okay. Now see that this table I have taken from the LPC 214X manual available on the net. So in that, in the GPIO part, you can have a GPIO register map as a table 65. Okay, so that is your legacy ARM peripheral bus accessible registers. Okay. Now see that the name of the registers are IO pin register, IO set register, IO direction register and IO clear register. So initially, whenever we want to use a GPIO for a chip like LPC2148, we are supposed to start with the direction, a direction register. Okay. So over here we are having the IODIR, that is input output direction register. Now, this input output direction register will decide the direction of the IO pins, that a particular pin we want to use it as input or we want to use it as output. Okay, so this direction register will set the particular port pin as input or output. Okay, so initially, as I told you, upon reset, all here pins are being set as input. Okay, so to set at output, a particular bit of this register is being set to logic 1. That we will see later on when we go for a programming example. Okay, so over here you can see that the direction register will decide the direction of the IO pin. If a particular pin is at logic 0, that means we are configuring that pin as input, and if we are setting that particular pin, then we are a particular bit of the IODIR, then we are configuring particular pin of the input output as output. Okay, so that is IODIR. Okay, now see that the reset value is 0, so all are being configured as input. Okay, for port 0, the address is E1000 to 8008, and the name of the register is IO0DIR, and for port 1 it is E1000 to 8018, and the name of the register is IO1DIR. So as I told you that there are two ports, port 0 and port 1, so both are having their separate registers, that is IO0DIR and IO1DIR, with having these addresses. Okay, all the peripherals in ARM7 are memory mapped IO, so all these registers are of memory. Okay, so they are memory mapped IOs, so to access them we need to write a program for a memory mapped IO. Means we are supposed to access a memory location. Okay, in that way we are supposed to write down the program. So once the direction of the IO pins is being decided as an input or output, okay, we can set or clear the particular IO pin. If we are configuring it as output and we want to set a particular pin, then that bit of the IO set register will be set to high. Okay, okay, so to set, the particular bit of the IO set register must be set to high, and to reset or clear a particular bit, IO clear register bit must be set to logic 1. Okay, so if you want to clear, the particular bit of IO clear will be set to logic 1, then that particular bit of the IO port will be cleared. Okay, if we are taking the GPIO port as an input port, then to take the input from the external devices, IO pin will be used. Okay, so that is your input output pin register. So whatever the external value that will came to this register, and from this register we can take it for further processing. Okay, so this is for input, and this too is to set and clear a particular output pin, and this is for the direction. Okay, so these are the few general purpose GPIO port registers. Okay, and these are the name of the registers and their addresses for port 0 and port 1. Okay, so we are having IO 0 pin, IO 1 pin, IO 0 set, IO 1 set, IO 0 DIR, IO 1 DIR, IO 0 clear, IO 1 clear. Okay, so these are the registers and these are the addresses. Okay, later on I'll show you the schematic diagram, and in that we will find that the port 1 is being connected to the LEDs of the MCB 2 and 40 board that we are using in the lab. Okay, so particularly this group of registers we are going to keep in mind. Okay, so that is your IO 1 pin, IO 1 set, IO 1 DIR, IO 1 clear, and these are the addresses that we are going to access for the direction, set, clear, and the pin register. Okay. Now see that the enhanced GPIO features provide a fast GPIO. Okay. So the fast GPIO registers are, that is fast IODIR. Okay. So for fast peripherals to achieve the time constraints or the time deadlines, fast GPIO can be used for better response time. Okay, so fast GPIO port direction control register is FIODIR as the direction register we have seen. Now if you want to mask, then there is a facility in the fast GPIO, so we can mask that particular pin. Okay, so there is no effect of all these registers. Okay, then in the same way we are in fast IO pin, fast IO set and fast IO clear. Okay, so normally the algorithm for a GPIO program is that initially in the pin connect block we will configure the pin select register in a way that we can use that particular pin of the port as output port, okay, or a GPIO port. After configuring that particular pin in the pin connect block as GPIO, we can choose the direction of that pin as input and output using the direction register. Once it has been configured as output, then we can set the particular bit of the port using IO set register, and we can clear the particular bit of the port using IO clear register. If we are configuring the direction register as input, then we are supposed to use the IO pin register to take the values from the external peripheral. Okay, this is how the things will work for GPIO in ARM7. Okay, so this is for the register description of the fast IO. Now this is the schematic of MCB2140 board that we are using in the lab. Okay, so this is the LPC2148 chip which is working on 12 MHz crystal oscillator, so the working frequency is 12 MHz. Okay, but which can be enhanced to 60 MHz using the registers of LPC2148, okay, or a clock divided circuitry. Okay, so this kit is comprising of LPC2148 board. We are having two serial ports coming out, that is the COM0 and COM1. There is a interrupt pin also which is being taken out, that is INT1. There is a facility to reset the pin also, so we are having a reset switch also on board, and we are having a 3.3 volt power supply, and the kit can be powered from USB also. Okay, there is a JTAG interface also to the kit for the debugging purposes, so we can use a Ulink JTAG for the debugging purposes. Okay, now see that for GPIO we are going to use the LED which are being interfaced to this particular kit. Okay, and we will go for a simple output program to control those LEDs. Okay, so to this kit, there is a speaker interface also from the audio out pin. There is an SD card interface also, okay, and our potentiometer is also being connected. Now see that This is the part that we are talking about for general purpose input output. Now you can see that this is the buffer IC, that is 74LBC244. Okay. Now the port pins P1.16 to P1.23 is being connected to the LEDs. So there are 8 LEDs which will show you the particular bit which is being outputted to this port pins. So these LEDs are being named as P1.16, P1.17, P1.18, 19, 20, 21, 22, and 23. Okay, so this is how the LEDs are being connected to the port pins of the kit. Okay, so let us go through a program for simply on and off of all these 8 LEDs at a time. Okay, now see that before we go through the program, you need to understand that ARM7, that the ARM7 is a pure 32-bit architecture. So all the bits, it will start from bit 0 to bit 31. Okay, so this will be the bit 7. Okay, so if you are talking about, so this will be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. If you are considering a whole 32-bit format, okay, in the same way, you are having 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. Okay? In the same way, from So this is the whole 32-bit format. Okay, so every time when you write a program, it's better to view the hexadecimal values in a 32-bit format. Okay, so where exactly the LEDs are being connected? If you are talking about the port, then again the port is a 32-bit port. Okay, and we are considering the port 1, that is P1.16 to P1.23. So it will came over here. If we consider it as a port pins, so LEDs are being connected to P1.23 to P1.16. Okay, that is where the LEDs are being connected. So if we are going to convert it into a hexadecimal value, then we need to make a group of 4. We need to make a group of 4. Okay, so total how many digits we will get? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So an 8-digit number in hexadecimal will represent a 32-bit representation in binary. Okay, so you can see that out of those 8 digits, okay, if we start with the MSB, then the first, second, third and fourth digit will represent the bit 16 to bit 23. So in the program you will see that that we are having, we are going to configure only that particular digit. Okay. So let us go through the assembly language program for the GPIO. Now see that for an assembly language program, every time this is the syntax. So these two lines will came first and the last line. Okay, so this is the syntax. So we are having area, startup code, code at 0th location. So every time we are starting the code from the 0th memory location. So these are the assembler directives. So we are having area, startup code, means our code will start at the 0th memory location. Then we are having the entry directive, which tells the assembler that now our program will start. Okay, and end, we will write end at the end of the program, so the assembler will understand at this point our program is ending. Okay. Now see that for port 1, the name of the registers are, that is our IO pin, IO set, IO DIR and IO clear. These are the name of registers that we had seen. So we had named them using the equate directive. So this is the equate directive, EQU. So whatever the 32 bit value we write over here, that value will be assigned to this name using the equate directive. So wherever in the program, when we write this name, the assembler automatically assumes the value. The assembler automatically assumes the 32-bit value. Okay? So for our understanding purpose, we have taken the names of the registers along with their addresses from the user's manual of MPC-2148. As in the register part, we had seen that our IO1 pin, okay, that is our IO1 pin is at E1000 to 8010, IO1 set is E1000 to 8014, IO1 DIR is E1000 to 8018, and IO1 clear is E1000 to 8001C. Okay, so this is what we are taking in the program. So we are just giving the name to these addresses in the program. Okay, so our E1000 to 8010 will be IO1 pin register, E1000 to 8014 is IO1 set, E1000 to 8018 is IO1 DIR, and E1000 to 8001C is IO1 clear register. Okay, so by using the equate directive, we are assigning the names to those addresses. Okay, so that is necessary. So whenever in the program when I write IO1 DIR, so instead of that it will take this value. That is the usefulness of the equate directive. Otherwise every time you are supposed to access a memory location by writing the address. So it is better to name that address as a register. Okay, so initially what we will do, in these three lines we are configuring the IO pin as output pins by using the direction register. Okay, so what we will do, we will load any register we can take. Okay, so we can load R0 with IO1 DIR. So after the execution of this instruction, the contents of R0 will be E1000 to 8018. Okay, that is the LDR instruction. Now we are loading R1 with 0x00FF0000. Okay, so why we are considering this value? Because this value resembles this 0000. Over here we are configuring it port pins P1.16 to P1.23 as output. So if we are taking all these bits at logic 1 and conceiving all the other bits at 0. So we will get 00FF00FF. So this we are configuring the port P1.23 to P1.16 as output. Okay, so that is the reason why we are writing this value in another register, because that value we want to send it to the direction register. Okay, so by simply writing store the contents of R1, that is 00FF0000, into this memory location. Okay, so the contents of R0. So what is R0? That is IO1DIR. What is IO1DIR? That is E1000 to 8018. Okay, so the store instruction will store this value to this address. Okay, means in the IO1DIR register we are sending the value, or we are storing this value 00FF0000. So P1.16 to P1.23 is configured as output pins. Okay, so once it is being configured as output pin, now we are going through a simple program to blink all the LEDs. Okay, so what we can do is that we can take two more registers, R4, and in that we will take the address of IO1 clear register, and we will load a value in another register, R3 00FF00, and if we send it to the clear register, then this particular bits are being cleared. Okay, this particular port bits are being cleared. Okay, so P1.16 to P1.23 are being cleared, means all the LEDs, as I shown to you in the schematic diagram. So whenever we write a logic 1 over here, then the LED will glow, then the LED is on. Okay, and whenever we write a logic 0, then the LED is off. Okay, so while clearing we are sending a logic 0 to that particular pin. Okay, but keep in mind, clear means we are setting the particular bit in the clear register, so that will send a logic 0 to the particular port pin. Okay, so that many times creates confusion to the beginners. Okay, so in the program you can see that these three lines will clear. Okay, this will clear P1.16 to P1.23. Then we are putting some delay. So we can have a 1 second delay approximately to see the blinking effect. Then these three lines will set P1.16 to P1.23. Okay, this will set. Again we are taking a delay for 1 second, and then we are taking an unconditional branch instruction to this particular instruction. So again it will clear, then a delay, then set, then a delay. Okay, so we are having a blinking effect. All the 8 LEDs will be off for some time, then on for some time, and then it will work in an infinite loop. Okay, so we can have a blinking effect of all the LEDs. Now to generate a delay, we can use the timer facility available inside the microcontroller, or we can use a loop also. Okay, so this is the normal way to write a delay without timers. Okay, so we are taking any register in R7, and we are taking a value of 00100010. Okay, this value normally gives you a 1 second delay. Okay, so we are simply writing a subtract instruction. We are subtracting 1 from the R7 value and putting the same value in the R7. We are supposed to subtract 1 till we will get 0 in R7. Okay, so we are comparing R7 with 0,0 after the subtraction, and we are writing branch if not equal to delay 1. So this will be in a delay, so it will subtract this much times. Okay, so it will be in loop for that much time, so that will generate a delay of approximately 1 second. Okay, so as soon as the R7 value will become 0 after the subtraction, it will came out. Okay, and the last instruction in the subroutine will be move PC,LR. So whenever we write BL delay, that is branch and link instruction, it will go to the subroutine delay, and what it will do, it will store the current program counter value in the link register. So the last instruction of the subroutine will be move PC,LR. So whatever the link register value will again go to the program counter. So the program execution go to the very next instruction after the subroutine which is being called. Okay, so that is the usefulness of move PC,LR. So that is the instruction that we write at the end of every subroutine to again go back to the main program. Okay, so that is the delay subroutine. Okay, so that is the simple GPIO program to blink the port pins. Okay, let us see the same program. Let us see the same program working in a simulator for the better understanding. So if I simply copies this particular program, now let us simulate it using a Kale Microvision software. Okay, now see that for Kale, see, I had stored the Kale in the Kale_ARM folder. In that you are supposed to go through the UVision 3 folder. In that you need to find out a UVision 3 exe. So this is the first screen of the Kale UVision 3. Okay, and we are going to simulate the assembly language program that we had discussed in this lecture. So we are supposed to close this. Now, to make a project, go to project, new project. So it will ask you to store that project. So I am storing the project in the same folder ARM examples, and in that my name folder is there. So in that you can make a new folder and name it first, or any name if you want to give, or GPIO. Okay, so in that I am writing GPIO. That is the name of the project you are going to save. After doing that, you are supposed to go to the Philips in this, and in that LPC2148 that we are using currently. Okay, so LPC2148, press on OK. Now when this pop-up window will open, in this pop-up window it will ask you to add a startup code to your project folder. Now whenever we are using an assembly language program, we will click on the no, and whenever we are going for a C language program using Kale UVision 3, we will press on yes. So currently we are going for an assembly language program, so we will press no to this. After going through that, we will right click on the target one options. In that, the crystal frequency must be 12, as I showed to you that the kit is having a crystal frequency of 12 MHz. In the output, if you want, you can click on the create hex file, and in debug we are using a simulator, so use simulator is there. Whenever we are going to use Kit in the lab. We will go for the U-Link ARM debugger. So we will use this and then we will have settings for that particular kit. Okay. So currently we are going for the simulation part. So use simulator will be used and then we will click on OK. So currently this is the initial settings you are supposed to do. Then to create a new file, we are supposed to click on this, or you can go to the file also and click on a new file. So text one will open. So in that, what I will do, I will copy the code that we are having. Okay, so you can see a star over here. So we are supposed to save it first. So in the same folder we are supposed to save as gpio.s. this is the extension for the source file in the assembly language. Okay, so we will write gpio.s in that and then we will save it. Okay, so once it is being saved, in target one there is a source group one which is being formed. We are supposed to right click that and add files to that. Okay, and we are supposed to click on gpio.s and edit, close. Now see that to check that that file is being added or not, we are supposed to simply double click on this. So a cursor will be shown on this side of the window. That means the file is being added. Okay, so once the program is entered, you can see the color changes in the window. So there is a color changes in the window which will appear when you save it as .s file, a gpio.s file. Okay, now let us build the target. Okay, so you can go in the project tab, you can build target, or you can directly build target from this icon also. So build target. Okay, so initially okay, so currently it is showing some syntax errors. Okay, so there are few errors in the program, like I have given few from the PPT. Okay, so let us save it again and rebuild it. Okay, so when there is no error, you can find a zero error zero warning message in the program. Okay, so once you get a zero error zero warning message in the program, okay, we can go through the debug part to debug it. Okay, so we can click on this icon, or we can go to a debug and a start stop debug. Okay, so when we click on this, the debug session will start. So in debug session you can see that the yellow arrow will came to the very first instruction in the program. So if the debug session is correctly initialized, you can see a yellow arrow is being shown to the very first instruction. Now in the debug window, in the project workspace, you can see the list of all the registers, that is R0 to R15, as well as you can go to the CPSR, SPSR also. Now for GPIO, as we are going through the slow GPIO interface, so we will go to the peripherals tab, and in GPIO slow interface, and we are using port 1. So over here we are supposed to click on port 1. Okay, so now you can see over here that these are the registers, that is IO1 DIR, IO1 set, IO1 clear, IO1 pin, and these are the pins. means these are the pins of the IC where we can see the values from bit P1.16 to P1.31, because these pins are being used by the system, these port pins. Okay, so the available port pins are P1.16 to P1.31 only, and out of these only 16 to 23 are being connected to the LED. Okay, so we can simply single step the program and see what we have in the direction set clear register, IO pin we are not using in the program, okay, and what value we will get on the pins. Is it clear? Or if everything is correct, we can directly run the program and we can see, okay. So let us first run the program and see the output, that the LEDs are actually blinking or not. So to run the program, we can simply go to the run button, okay, or in debug tab, this run button is there, so we can click on this. So you can see that our program is running correctly, and we are having P16 to P23 is having the blinking effect. Okay, now to understand the logic, what you can do is that from here, once we want to stop, we will stop the program, we will came out from the debug session. Okay, now if we want to do some changes, after doing the changes we are supposed to save it again, and then again we are supposed to build it, and then we will go to the debug again. Okay, now if we want to single step and see the results, then we can see it using single step. So this is a single step button, that is tab into, so one instruction is being executed, okay, and this one is the step over, so a particular instruction is being overstepped or is not being executed, and the program execution will go to the next instruction. Okay, so for single stepping, what we can do is that we will click on this, so you can see that the R0 is having the value of IO1DIR, so our IO1DIR value is E1000 to 8018, so that we are having in R0. In the same way, our R1 will get 00FF0000 after executing LDR R1, comma this instruction, and now we are storing it at the location. Okay, so that is your IO1DIR. So over here we are having IO1DIR, so we will have the value on this register. Okay, so our IO1DIR will get this value. So all the pins P1.16 to P1.23 is being set as an output port. Okay, once we have done that, it is already cleared, so the next three lines will clear the port. As it is already cleared, this will not show you the effect, so we are taking the clear in R4, value in R3 and clearing the pins, so it will not show you. Now BL delay will go to the delay program, so we are just step out from that, so we can simulate for the set one. Okay, so if we simulate IO set, taking the value and then storing it into the set, now the pins are set, and then again the delay subroutine will be called. Okay, and in that way the things will work. Okay, so if we run the program, you can see the blinking effect. Okay, or you can single step it and you can go through the logic. Okay, so that is all we have for the GPIO programming of the ARM7. If you want to change the sequence of the bits, these are the registers that you are supposed to change. You are supposed to change the value of IO1 set and IO1 clear to clear a particular bit or to set a particular bit. If you are going for an input program, then you are supposed to take the input from the IO1 pin register, okay, and then compare that for logic 1 and 0 using the compare instruction. Okay, so that's all we have for today's lecture. So today we are concluding with the general purpose input output programming for ARM7 microprocessors. Thank you very much for watching.